have Karl Johanson from the magazine Neo-Opsis deliver a talk on science fiction and just how important it is. Karl Johanson is an owner, editor of Neo-Opsis Science Fiction Magazine with his wife, is the owner of Neo-Opsis Science Fiction Magazine with his wife, Stephanie. Neo-Opsis has won two Aurora Awards. That's a big deal, that's awesome. Karl is also a former editor of the four-time Aurora-winning magazine Under the Ozone Hole. Karl's publication credits include work in Polar Borealis, On Spec Magazine, I can't say these words, Perihelion, Sci-Fi Journal, Monday Magazine, Stitches, the Magazine of Medical Humor, and the anthology Here Be Monsters, 7. As a writer, designer, tester of computer games, Karl has done work for North Star Games, Disney Interactive, and Sanctuary Woods Multimedia. Many of the games were science fiction or fantasy related. Karl does work as a movie extra and a civilian actor for Canadian Forces training exercises. Thank you so much, Karl, for being here. So let's give him a huge round of applause.
I got some notes to keep my thoughts in order. I didn't have a lot of time to get a complete speech put together. If anybody can't hear me at the back, give me one of these. I noticed some of the your team were pretty good at enunciating, making sure everybody could hear them. She mentioned the Aurora Awards. I should say before I start, every one of the Aurora Awards my name's on was part of a team. So I understand what it's like, you guys getting a team together. Under the Ozone Hole magazine, we had quite a creative team doing a news zine. With Neo-Opsis, when my wife Stephanie and I both worked at Disney Interactive, as she mentioned that in the intro, when the studio closed, we realized we were kind of addicted to the idea of team creativity. Working with such an incredible group of people who work together from so many different aspects of the product, from the programming to the sound design, the animation, the writing, the basic game design, the testing, which is a lot of what we did. That felt really good. And when the studio closed, Stephanie said, we have to do something to stay in that realm of creative intensity and creative teamwork. There are so many creative people in Canada, although we do get stories from all over the world. We knew that something like Neo-Opsis could work. We're working on our 30th issue right now, so it's been going fairly good. So basically the idea I was going to talk about tonight is the importance of science fiction. The basics is entertainment is an important thing. If nothing else, it gives humans something to do other than fight. So in that sense alone, that's enough. But science fiction has a lot more than that. It's about ideas and about how those ideas influence people, how people influence the ideas. In general, when people ask me what kind of stories you want for Neo-Opsis, I'll tell them, don't just give me the idea. You know, don't just lead up and then here's the big thing. Give me the implications of that idea. And doesn't always work out in terms of a really good bit of implications. Asimov did one that I thought was brilliant, where in the 50s, he wrote a story about somebody with a portable phone. Pretty mainstream by today's standards, but at the time, people didn't have them. And he didn't just say, okay, ta-da, he's got a portable phone, and that's the exciting end. It was, he had a portable phone, and everywhere he went, and people were calling him. His wife's calling him, his boss calling him, his kids are calling him. He gets tired of it, he turns it off. He gets home about 4 hours later, and the police have been looking for him for 2 hours because his wife's worried about him. So he came up with the implications that not only will we be able to communicate continuously with other people, we might be able to do it to the point that it's annoying. So if you publish such a story today, it may not seem like science fiction, even though it's about technology, because we would consider it mainstream. But he was a visionary in that. One I didn't like so much was one when my wife found her grandfather's collection of science fiction, not knowing he was a fan. And one of the stories she read, and she's like, why is this in a science fiction collection? And it was a man that was lonely, and he needed a maid. He hired a maid, and he thought she was quite attractive, so they got married. And then she wanted a dishwasher, and then she wanted a clothes washer, and then an automatic clothes dryer, and oven that worked automatically, and he got disgusted and divorced her and then hired an ugly maid. And Stephanie was like, why is this in science fiction? Like, what is the point? And I said, well, when was it written? And it was written in the 20s. I said, well, people didn't have dishwashers. They didn't have clothes washers. So this was somebody who looked into the implications of changing technology and how it would influence society, that you might have a wife who gets lazy and wants the machines to do everything. But it's not really a good message. It's a pretty misogynist message, and the idea that you marry somebody for their ability to do things for you, or the husband is supposed to just provide. And it wasn't even delivered that well. I think Pride and Prejudice delivered those messages of people marry somebody just for what their wealth is, or for what they can bring to the family, or okay, she's attractive, I'll marry her and it'll give us status. I think that message was delivered far better in a different genre. But science fiction does manage to pull out some incredibly interesting important points. And I think some of the very best literature in history has been in the genre. I'll just bring up one, Asimov's short story, Nightfall, where a planet has seven stars, and so it's light all the time. They don't have candles, they don't have electric lights, they don't need them, it's light all the time. And their civilization collapses every 2,000 years. And there's religion about why, that a dragon eats the planet every 2,000 years and everything goes to hell. And the scientists discover, well, every 2,000 years, six of the brighter stars are on one side of the sky and the dimmest, farthest star is on the other side. And it gets eclipsed for an entire day. And they're plunged into darkness. And they've never had to deal with darkness before. And it was showing a way that society can take myths and legends and look into them and go, well, wait a minute, maybe there is something behind this. Maybe it's not the way they thought it was, and a group of scientists are rapidly trying to figure out ways to survive this. And again, I think it's one of the greatest works of literature. I think one of the greatest works of art in the history of mankind is in the genre of science fiction, but it's a song. It's Armageddon from Prism. I don't know if anybody's heard it, written in Vancouver by Lindsay Mitchell, performed by Prism. And it's, at first, listen, it may sound just like it's a song about war, but it's about the idea of people at Elvis's anniversary of Elvis's funeral thinking he's the Messiah. Rock and roll was the message, and this is the Messiah, and they're waiting for him to come back to life. And when the Messiah comes back to life, that triggers Armageddon. And the people are singing Armageddon, Carry Me Home. And it's a brilliantly inspiring song. I've heard thousands of people at concerts all singing along Armageddon, Carry Me Home, none of whom want nuclear war. But it does show how easy it is for a cause, however trivial, however silly, like the idea that Elvis is the direct manifestation of the creation of the universe, people will use that as an excuse to fight, and it's a warning. And it's such a brilliantly delivered warning that you even want to sing along with it, even as you can tell in the back of your head, no, I really don't want this war to happen. Anyway, that song influences me a lot, so I got to check my notes again because I'm kind of hooked in that point for just a moment. Another thing important about science fiction is something Steve Pinker talked about, the decline of violence over time in history. We see so much violence in the news, and we have access to so many varieties of news, not just, you know, the newspaper like people had in the 1800s. So much, we're bombarded with how much violence there are in the world. Every time two people fight, you might see it. But the world is getting considerably more peaceful. There's a lot less wars. The wars we have going on right now, considerably fewer people. Interpersonal violence is down. And again, we perceive the opposite. And we're not entirely sure why it's declining. It might be because there's more interesting things to do, like reading science fiction. And I think that's part of it. But when you're reading, you're getting inside another person's head. They're a virtual person that you're creating in your own mind. When somebody reads Oliver Twist, they suddenly see these street people, not just as these annoyances, these dangerous people, these criminals. They can get right inside the mind of that person when they're reading that story. And all of us, we're used to being in other people's minds. We watch shows all the time, we read all the time. It's not something that, you know, well, you have the I'm right and all those other people have opinions that aren't quite right. You can change perspectives when you're interacting in fiction. And because science fiction is willing to tackle really tough questions, and we're facing a lot of tough questions in the world, it gets people experienced in the idea of, I really better watch what's going on in the world. There's too many examples to go into. I don't want to talk for 4 hours on all the possibilities, but we all know things that are happening with technologies that are influencing us. Complex ethical discussions, ethical issues that are going on, and science fiction gives us that opportunity to consider them. And because I'm going to quote somebody, I'm going to be reading from this one. I want to make sure I get their quote right. Just before that, I'll talk. Science fiction is often thought of as something that predicts the future. It's not really a prediction. There's a lot of science fiction that got things wrong. Star Trek, they had their communicators in one hand and their tricorder in the other. And everybody here who's got a phone, it's got the bicorder built into it. And the communicator communicated with the computer. Nobody on Star Trek had the incredibly powerful computers we're all walking around with in our pockets right now. They weren't predicting the future, but they were making us think about the future and consider the future. So I'll get to my quote here. There's variations on a common saying. The earliest version of which I could find is attributed to George Santayana. Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. A paraphrased version of this that's quite common that I like even more is, those who fail to study the past are destined to repeat its mistakes. Now to add to that point, and I'll finish my talk by making this one, those who fail to consider the future, as you can do with science fiction, those who fail to consider the future are destined to create new mistakes. Thank you.
Questions. We're going to do questions actually as well. So yeah, I thought I'd put that out there.
Okay. Just before questions, I should mention with the Aurora Awards, nominations for things produced last year have just closed. The Aurora Awards are the Science Fiction and Fantasy People's Choice Awards, so everybody here could nominate or vote if they wanted to. Next year, after the new year, the Arca podcast will be eligible to be nominated if anybody in the room wants to. If they get enough nominations, they'll be on the final ballot.
So
I thought I'd
just... So you all know what you have to do. Looking at all of you in the darkness.
Anyway. So yeah, you have opportunity. If anybody is a writer, questions about a science fiction book writing, the publishing, or anything, anybody's got a favorite show or any questions on anything, I'd be happy to.
What got you personally interested in science fiction itself? How early did you start?
Oh, sorry, could you say again?
What got you interested in science fiction? When did you start? How early?
Oh, how young? Star Trek came out in 66, so I would have been 4. So that clearly was an influence on me. Not the only one. In terms of writing Isaac Asimov, some of his short stories really impressed me. Got me thinking, got me finding this is fun, this is interesting. School didn't get me that interested in science fiction. The science fiction they pulled up for me wasn't that interesting, wasn't that inspiring. Hopefully it was for others, but yeah, so it evolved over time. There's a host of shows. 2001 A Space Odyssey I saw when it came out in the theaters initially, and I kind of went, wow, what the hell was that? Again, it gave people pause to thought, to think, and it didn't spoon feed the audience. It didn't say, I'm going to have the narrator tell you everything that's going on, which is its strength and its weakness. Yeah. Anything inspire you to like the genre? Hopefully the podcast.
The podcast, yes. The voice maker is saying Mass Effect, and that's very true.
Yeah. Yeah, which one was it?
Mass Effect.
Oh,
video,
yeah.
Video games in general. It's interactive. You get to take the place literally of the heroes and whatnot.
Yeah, science fiction is occurring through a huge amount of computer games. Partly because it's really interesting. You can do amazing visuals, you can do unusual worlds. Fantasy as well. We got to work on Treasure Planet just before Disney Interactive Studio closed, in a 2D environment with 3D. pirate ships in space shooting laser cannonballs at each other and totally interactive, and a whole thread of storyline mixed into it as well. The first computer game I worked on was Riddle of Master Lou, based on Robert Ripley, who's some say it was the basis for Indiana Jones, that they kind of modeled him on that. And we didn't have a lot of room for video. We didn't have a lot of room for audio. Audio compression, video compression technologies weren't there yet. It was all on one CD. But we still managed to get an incredible amount of fairly interactive story going on with the incredible environments. Looking at the games today, it's like, oh my God, they've got so much of a world going on. And I find it's affecting my reaction to non-interactive fiction. I watch a movie and I'm thinking, no, don't go over there. I want to go follow this storyline that was here. It was interesting. And if you're in a massive multiplayer game, you can go over there. But I found it watching one of the Star Wars prequels. It's like, no, I don't care about that. Just, you know, I just wanted to grab the controller and move it, and it didn't work, so. Yeah, at the back.
Looking back on your career, is there one particular project or creation that you would say you were particularly proud of or particularly excited to have been a part of?
Oh, excited. I can answer the opposite first. I am proud of my work on a movie called Dawn of the Living Sox in 1980. It was a matter of, we wanted to work on a project, we wanted to work together. And the project is, you know, 45 minutes of the Earth being attacked by Sox and the secret organization fighting them. But it's silly, so in one sense I'm not proud of it. We did it. We coordinated people like they did. We got the project finished, so I'm damn proud of that. That was a long time ago. I managed to get it put up to YouTube, partly because I was inspired by, you know, you getting something finished and putting it up. And said, there's people who were in that movie who never saw it when it was finished in 82. So yeah, I was pretty proud of that. The first time I sold a short story, I did the woohoo dance you're supposed to do. And actually, when I meet other authors at conventions, I'm often asking them, do you do the dance when you sell something still? Like, you know, you are, Dave Duncan, who sadly passed away recently, is a Victoria author, formerly from Calgary and formerly from Scotland. He published 53 novels before he died, and he wouldn't answer the question if he still does the woo-woo dance, or if he still did the woo-woo dance just before he passed. But I think that he did. He would have said no if it was no. The first computer game I worked on, the Riddle of Master Lou, I wasn't just proud, I was starstruck. That everybody knows what imposter syndrome is, I think, you know, where you think, oh, somebody's going to figure out I don't actually belong here. And I want to tell you all, you goddamn well belong where you're doing the work. Congrats on whatever projects you're working on. You do belong there. I was sitting there typing with two fingers, and slowly, because I'm not a good typer. And I thought, not only am I a science fiction fan working with professionals who doesn't belong here, I can't even type properly. What am I doing here? 95% of my brain was fine, going, I can handle this work, I'm good at it. But I had that little niggling, everybody's gonna know I don't belong here, I wanna go hide. And then I watched our head writer, he worked on Star Trek The Next Generation and Quincy and Charlie's Angels, a number of TV shows, and then was writing interactive dialogue, which stunned me watching him do it. But when I watched him type, he used this hand for the shift key in his hand to type like this. So he used one less finger on pretty much than I did. And I haven't had imposter syndrome since. And I'm telling you, because I don't want any of you to have it either, right? You guys are the real deal, whatever it is you're doing. So, I don't know, I rambled a bit. Hopefully that answered your question.
Thank you.
You have any others? Oh, yeah.
What is the most valuable lesson you think that can be gleaned from science fiction?
Oh, most valuable lesson, yeah. Consider the future. Things are going to be different. There's an insult they use in business about, you know, when you've got a bad manager, you say he's all poised to win the last war. He's using the tools of what went on before and thinking everything's going to be the same in the future. And we're running into that today. We're dealing with environmental issues that some people are just in complete denial of. because they don't want to, they don't want to face them. There are religions that say, you know, oh no, oh, the rainbow in the sky, that meant no more, God's never going to do anything related to the environment or the weather or the climate again. So therefore the climate can't be changing. And then they turn around half a minute later and say, yeah, but those gays over there are causing the hurricanes. Sometimes in the same sentence, which of course. So it's that. So that's an important one, is recognize that as new data comes in, things might be different. And it's not just in terms of technology, in terms of ethics. Sam Harris, philosopher speaker, he said one of the best conversations we can have is about what constitutes good ethics. Because I've modified my behavior over the years. When somebody's made an ethical point, I've thought about it, and then I thought about the underlying basis of that ethical point, and I thought, yeah, I was doing this before, it seemed okay to me, maybe it's not, maybe it is okay in some circumstance, but maybe it's better if I don't do that, or if I don't say that, or if I don't word things that way. And I think science fiction lets us jump into that in a hard way. There's a lot of differences in humans, but there's a lot of similarities. If you watch a movie where you're dealing with extremely alien cephalopods, and then you look at all the humans around you, and suddenly that person whose only difference is they dress differently, they have slightly different colored skin, they have slightly different interests in who they fall in love with, those differences suddenly start to become trivial in the face of science fiction. When you're showing somebody, look, these two people are quite alien and different, and they love each other. What's wrong with that? And more people, I think, are starting to recognize, well, maybe there isn't anything wrong with that. So that questioning, being ready for what's going to happen in the future by looking at what we know that we didn't know in the past, and that willingness to consider based on the complexities of those. Anyway, I think that sort of answers it. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Anybody else? I might say one other one just for any writers. Sometimes people ask me, what do you want in the story? I mentioned before, don't just give me the idea, give me the implications of the idea. But there's one other one. People will often tell you, it's all about the characters. That's when you're writing, remember, it's all about the characters. And I'll have to say I disagree with that one. It's like when you're kids and you say, would you rather lose your heart or your entire GI tract? And of course, it doesn't matter. You're gonna die. So if you've got a story that doesn't have interesting characters that the audience will relate to or be antagonistic towards in some way or another, the story fails, I think. If the story doesn't have interesting situations, interesting conflicts, interesting environments, the story fails too. So you wanna combine those. I understand where they're coming from when they said the characterizations and characters are important. But if you don't have all those elements interacting together, it's like, okay, I took my heart out, but you know, I'm gonna die if I don't have the other parts. So anyway, thank you very much. And thanks for having me.
Thank you.
I have to say a couple words, and then I hope you all keep drinking and, you know, talking and being awesome. Housekeeping things in terms of how you can support the podcast, if you can listen to the podcast. And then if you like it, you can rate or review it. Seems pretty boilerplate, I know. But my personal dream anyway is to, get the podcast on the front page of iTunes, if I may be so bold. And I need everybody's help to do it. And the way that we do it is we listen, or at least pretend we listen and say we like it, and then we tell our friends to listen to it because it's a great podcast. Even if you didn't listen to it, you could recommend it and you'd be okay. That's kind of my goal. To, as an artist, and as someone who has worked with podcasting for not even 2 years, but you know, a year and a half, the podcast I ran before this was an artist interview series, interviewing artists in their studios around Canada. But I'm now doing this audio drama, and knowing maybe what some of you know about my practice in terms of making otherworldly type paintings, is to create a culture of science fiction or thinking and making stories surrounding science fiction that might help us think about the future, think about where we are now, because that's really the only tool that we have in our sort of arsenal right now to combat a lot of the problems that you know, that are going on, and you know, the problems that will exist, like more acutely so in the future. So to do that, we really just have to spread the word. Like you know, it's just, that's why I need you to tell all your friends. I need you to rate the podcast. Don't bother with other platforms. Just use Apple Podcasts. And if you don't have an iPhone and the podcasting app, you can just go onto your browser and iTunes. And if you don't have a Mac, like, what are you in this day and age? I don't know. But just rate the podcast wherever you can, and review it if you feel compelled. It helps so much. Like, I can't even begin to tell you, it really helps in just word of mouth, getting it out there. If you do feel like supporting the podcast in any way, there's multiple links on the website page to do that. You can do this great little thing called Buy Me a Coffee, which is a little $3 one-time donation. You can do it as often or as not at all if you want, but it'd be great if you did, because the one thing that, as there are many students in this room, one thing you should know about the podcast is that how we made it is with students and all of you, and getting access to a free recording studio in the music department. And the next time around, we're not going to be able to do that. So if you want to see season two happen, reach out to people. If you know rich people, basically send them my way. but also, if you spread the word about this podcast, then it will just, hopefully, there'll be those people who do want to see season two, who love it enough. I know I'm working my butt off to make that happen, but it really helps with your support. It takes a community, a village, to make something happen of this magnitude.